as I said, my name is Steve. I've been with Siemens now for 9 years. This is the first panel I have put together, but certainly not the first one I've been working on. The XLS system is what we have here in this panel. The main fire panel is down here. There are five more on each riser, east side and west side.
Five more
sub-panels, not that have the controls, but the circuit cards are in cabinets on each floor, starting with the lower level on the east riser and the lower level on the right west riser, going all the way up to the fourth floor. All right, so each riser is going to have a voice module, the controls. If they lose the main voice from this fire panel, it will take over, so you still have voice protection. You'll have a network card, so it communicates with everybody else. It has a loop, a DLC, which is a digital loop card. That is where your smokes and your pulls and your heats, all your initiating devices run off of.
So you're just splitting it then? So you got one on either side of the building?
Yes.
And then boom, I have a loop for my addressable devices, a loop for each one, split the building, loop, 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 loop.
Yes.
So 10 loops.
Yes.
Gotcha.
Absolutely. In addition to the loops on each floor, on each riser, you also have a strobe card or two for each riser, and you have one or two speaker cards, amplifier cards, for each riser. So you are very well protected in this building. I'm gonna make a salesman joke, but I better not, I'm on camera.
he hit pause, go ahead.
All right, gotcha. All right, the main thing from an operator standpoint, I want to know is if somebody calls me at 3 o'clock in the morning, I gotta come out here and shut this panel down or shut it up. All right, I love it. One of these lights up top is going to be lit. Like for example, we have a troubles active right now, okay? And I'm going to have a white button, not grayed out, some white like this one is, right here saying acknowledge troubles. Once I push that, panel silence, all troubles are now acknowledged.
So it acknowledges all the troubles.
Absolutely.
You don't have to scroll through.
That's correct.
Okay.
A brief example is if I put power supply, just to induce a trouble, all I did on that power supply was disconnect the batteries. All right. My trouble light's flashing. Acknowledge my troubles. Right, and then I can reset the system if I'd like. Having said that, don't reset the system if the troubles are in, or they're just going to come right back again and you're like, it won't shut up. Well, yeah, just silence it until all the troubles are resolved.
And they should restore their own?
Yes.
Okay.
You're going to say out when the troubles are out.
Correct. When the trouble comes in, excuse me, in trouble, if the trouble restores, it's going to come up out very briefly. It's going to beep two or three times, and then it's going to disappear, self-restore. Or it's just going to self-restore that quick, as it just did.
So why is the yellow light still on?
Still got troubles.
Right. We still have four troubles currently right now. Let's see where these guys are. Got two power supplies, which is this big unit right here, always on the bottom right corner. Two of them on two of the risers that are in trouble for overheating the batteries. And that problem is, as soon as I bring the parts back out here, it'll be gone.
Okay.
Right, so that's why you have four active troubles right now. It gives you a charger fault against here, and a thermistor fault, which is actually this tiny resistor looking animal on this corner, saying I'm overcharging your batteries, they're 100 amp hours, it's gonna take me too long, and they're probably getting hot. Simple as that, what the problem is. Okay, I've got to reconnect.
So those have to be fixed?
Yes.
Okay.
How are the batteries? Are the batteries all right?
Well, when I replace batteries, I will put brand new batteries in.
Okay, gotcha. Can you date those when you put them in?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. The insides of your fire panels on all the risers as well here are similar. I talked about the DAC NIC card. No circuit cards inside this panel should be reset, removed, and replaced, reinstalled while the system is hot, with the exception of the DAC NIC. The DAC NIC is always on the top left corner. It is on every panel. That is your voice. All right. That one needs to be done with a hot swap. So this guy's all right, but all of these others on all the panels, make sure you have the panel powered down if you do anything like that. Reset the cards, whatever you need to do. Power the system back up.
So reset the card, you have to take it out?
Yes.
And what would you, why would you have to reset a card?
He just asked me if I reset the card, do I need to remove it from the panel? The correct answer is no. Each card's got a reset button on the face of it. All right. Fingertip may be blunt enough to push it in, or you maybe need an ink pen tip or a pencil. Just momentary. Sometimes if you jam them in too hard, they're going to get stuck behind the faceplate. So just a gentle popping in and out. It will cause that card to, if it's a voice card, it may cause it to go a little squirrely on you. Light's going to come up all over the place. Don't look at it anymore, because that's what I do. Just don't worry about it. It's going to clear itself back up.
What would you need to reset the card, the individual card?
If I had, like, for example, a DLC card, it's your smokes and your pulls, your initiating devices. If I had a short on the circuit, it's not going to clear itself. It'll say short. And you'll have to come up there and just push that reset button, and that will clear the card.
Clear the card. I want to go back to when you said the trouble's restoring its own. Uh-huh. I should reset it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what I'm thinking is once I reset it, I know it silences it, but I mean, once I acknowledge it, silences it.
Right.
But once I reset it, the trouble will still be there, right? For instance, like when Curry just asked why. The lights still up, we still have trouble panels.
We still have four troubles out on the field panels right now.
Okay.
The example that I turned off the battery here.
Uh-huh. Okay. And the battery's overheating now.
I got it, yes, out there on the field.
Right.
I got a fifth trouble came in and said your main panel's battery is off.
Uh-huh.
Okay. As soon as I reset the battery, it's going to come in here in a second. When it does, we'll see the fifth trouble pop up.
Right. And then you reset it, and then it'll also restore that.
Yes. Man, way to go. I don't have a screwdriver on me to try something more different. I wouldn't either.
Need a flathead?
No.
There we go. Yes, I didn't put one black.
That's all right. All right. I got a trouble just popped in.
Right.
Main panels, power supply, no battery detected.
Okay.
If you were to call a Siemens at this point and say, okay, this is the trouble I've got.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, sure. Go ahead and acknowledge it. So the person on the other end of the phone saying, okay, hold on. Mm-hmm. If you hit more information right here,
mm-hmm.
And the light's backlit on it. If you pick the particular trouble in question, mm-hmm. You scroll up and down to it,
mm-hmm.
And go more information, then here's the address,
mm-hmm.
In the middle. It says colon 209.
Mm-hmm.
I know we're talking about main panel. 209 is the address of the fire panel, of the battery.
Right.
If a smoke detector was going in trouble, okay, you'll say smoke detector, lower level, east side,
mm-hmm.
Server room, all right, and you can scroll to that device, escape, back me back out of it, smoke detector, lower level, east side server room,
mm-hmm.
All right, scroll to it, I hit more information, it'll say colon 12-37,
mm-hmm.
Okay, 12 is the loop, dash 37 is the smoke detector,
mm-hmm.
All right, Then I can get escape and come back out again.
Hey, Jay, we got to get what's going on, put the count number and all that on there, right?
Yeah.
So my thing is, yeah, okay, so now reset it. Set up. I should reset it, right?
If I were to reset it right now,
uh-huh.
It all comes right back in trouble.
Because all those troubles are still there.
Because you had a car.
Right. They're in trouble right now because nothing has been cleared.
Okay, well, that's what I meant by... That's why I didn't understand when you said once you reset it, it'll restore on its own. That's what I was like.
Okay.
No. Certain troubles, but those battery troubles right now is something they have to fix.
Right.
Yeah. Right. So we're looking at the battery right here. All right. By throwing that toggle switch back on,
mm-hmm. it, gotcha. Right.
We're immediately back down to four trolls.
Gotcha.
It's self restored and the number returned to whatever's current.
Okay. Okay. Gotcha. I'm thinking, I'm going to just reset, restore it. It resets it and clears on its own. What a panel.
No. And that would not be good. Self-resetting panels would make me very nervous.
Right. Like, wow, what a panel.
All right. The things that you would want to know is I've got a trouble. It tells me what the device is. The labels are pretty good for where they are. I would scroll down to them, and I would hit more information. And it would, again, give me the label, what type of the device is. PSC in this case is a power supply controller. The address is 19. All right, so if I were to go over to XLS fire system, R is for remote, D is for voice. All right, if I were to go to remote voice panel number one, which is that this one is telling me is where the power supply is, that's in the lower level east side. I'd go into it, I'd open up the fire panel door, and I know that I've got a trouble on the fire on the power supply itself for overcharging. If this told me a smoke detector or a pull station, all the smoke detectors, all the pull stations, tampers and flows, etc., are all labeled here on the site with their addresses on in nice. I'm looking above the ceiling, you see the nice orange tape on each device. So you'll find it that way, no problem.
So if I got one missing with orange tape, I'm calling you.
If you have one without tape, by all means.
All right, I need your card before you leave.
You got it.
And my question is, will there be a book?
There is a book.
With an address, you know, with an address location. In other words, like address number 95 is first floor, east side, room, whatever.
Yes, the correct answer is yes. The best way to give me, I will give you a list, a points list.
Yeah, points list, yeah, that's right. A big thing. That way you know where mm-hmm. to go to look at a trouble device.
Absolutely, I will send an email so you can distribute to everyone.
Carrie Butler, FairfaxCounty.gov. Todd has it,
give him Todd. All right. Escape back out to look at the main menu. The same thing comes in. Alarms are your highest priority. Supervisories. We don't have any security devices on this fire panel. So alarms, supervisories, and troubles. If the fire panel is in alarm, the building is going off, you can acknowledge the alarm. That stops the beeping right here in this panel.
Mm-hmm.
The building is still going active.
Yeah.
The second light beside it is going to say, audible silence. If you do not hit the audible silence, you'll never be able to reset the fire alarm system. Okay? So once you get the panel silenced, then the reset light will come on white like it is now, and you'll be able to reset.
But that's something we would leave up to the fire department when you touch it.
Yes. Fairfax County says let it ring till we know what's going on.
That's right. Fire department has to do it.
Let it ring. Yeah.
Is the fire pump system going to alarm?
If the fire pump goes on, it's going to trigger water flow somewhere. So yes, the water flow is what's going to put you
in. I got that training set for next week, James.
I think it triggers the jockey pump, but any water flow, whether it be a main or whether it be a riser, is definitely going to put your building in water. In which case, when we had it before while we were building the system up, acknowledge, silence, leave it alone until everything else is played out. Let's see here. One point that I would want to know, let's say you all came out, you had the panel beeping, acknowledged the trouble, scroll down, hit more information, and gave you the information that says, okay, the smoke detector, lower level server room, and its address was 16. The fire alarm devices, if they're an alarm, they're gonna flash red. For Siemens equipment, if it's an alarm, it's gonna flash red. If it's a trouble on it, it's gonna be amber, which is just a lighter shade of red. But red is gonna be very obvious. Amber, you're gonna be kind of questioning it.
So it's okay. Pretty close to the green flash.
Yeah, it is. It really is kind of stuck in the
middle. Just lay your face up against it, Jay.
All right, normal state, you'll see with these devices up in the ceiling, the smokes, the relays, they're gonna be flashing green. That's the normal indication. It flashes green once every 3 to 4 seconds. So if you're trying to figure out which one of these devices is the one in question, aside from the label on it, is gonna be flashing off color. All right. You can certainly swap all the devices off out in the field hot. You don't need to worry about that.
Is it self-addressable? Or do you have to address a device?
No. You definitely have to call Siemens out. I don't think Young Electric would be supporting that aspect for you guys, but you definitely have to call Siemens out to program a device. You have to call Siemens out to program any changes to the fire panel itself.
Now the devices, is there a programmer available?
It can be purchased. It may even be included.
Should be included.
To the contract.
Yeah, it should be included, yeah.
But I do not know where it is. I'm sure it's not on the site right now.
But James, we have.
It's not the same. That's the MXL.
It is. The MXL has two of them. One of them is bright yellow.
Yeah.
It looks like an old jukebox.
You got dome top. Case.
Yep. That's the one you use, yes.
Okay. So that can be used. Yes, that's right. That's an X. MXL or X.
Yes. Okay. You will make sure you change the system type from MXL to XLS because they're two totally different languages. Okay. For the lack of a better term, that describes it best. I would change it to XLS. All I have to do with the XLS system is give it an address. The fire alarm programming here determines whether this relay is a supervisory or if it's a trouble or it's an alarm. So I don't have to worry about that out in the field. Just give it the address number 35, plug it back in, and you're good to go.
Is it a direct input like 35, or do you have to add in a dash or a zero anywhere?
No, strictly the number.
Okay.
XLS uses three numbers because it can go as high as 252 devices per loop. So I would put 015 for address 15.
That's what I'm asking.
There you go. Yes, because it's going to come up default at address 1. So if I punched in address 15, it's actually going to say 115.
Right.
That's why I say you need to put in
three digits.
Total
right.
Digits. Right. Okay. The DPU, device programming unit for programming devices, has a function on it called loop test. Extremely helpful here with these fire alarm systems. All right, I can take the wires off the field from your riser panels. Take the wires off, connect them with the alligator clips that are come installed, and do a loop test. You'll say loop test, you push that button, and it will ping all the devices on each loop. In this particular building, I have not seen, with the exception of the penthouse fourth floor level, I haven't seen more than 30 devices on a loop. So
you got a lot of room for expansion.
You got unlimited expansion in this build. I mean, just flat out unlimited. So if you were to push the loop test button, it's gonna ping every device. It's gonna say, okay, you have 35 devices that are responding. And I can push the detail button, and it says it's gonna show that address 1 is a P for photo, address 2 is a R for relay, address 3 is a D for a dual unit, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It'll tell you. And if a device is malfunctioning, it'll flash. If a device is an alarm, it'll flash. If it's unsure because the device itself has kind of lost all communication, it'll give you a U. So it really points you in the right direction. It'll also tell you if there's a ground fault on that particular loop, but so will the circuit cards. So it's nice to know, but not necessarily of value.
The big thing would be determining which circuit card has the ground fault. So the right. So let's just say like we went to the east side over here,
okay.
And there's a ground fault, which is going to show here too.
Right.
Is it going to tell you that I'm detecting a ground fault from
yes.
the east? So it's going to help you trace it. So you're not like, Jesus Christ, this is a big building. I'm going to go.
Correct. Every panel, every circuit. I can't say every circuit card because it's going to prove wrong. Your DAC net, which is your voice system. Your NIC-C, which is your network card, this is what's talking to all the risers. All right, it'll tell you if there's a ground fault on it. Your digital loop card, device loop card, it's gonna say the same thing. Opens, shorts, ground faults on loop 12, on loop 22. So in this particular building, starting with the lower east, it goes loop 12, 22, 32, 42, 52, crosses over 62 all the way down to, I think it's 102, if my math does right. Each loop card will tell you if there's a ground fault on it. You can pop off these Phoenix connectors while the system is hot. That's not a problem at all. Pop them off, you'll see the ground fault go away. You know the problem's out in the field and not a problem with the circuit card. The
power supply does the same thing too. If you have a ground fault, the power supply.
I would not. Ground fault. The power supply does tell you if there is a ground fault, but the power supply, depending on the panel, branches off to many different things. The enunciator, for example, is subordinate. It would come in here and show against either the power supply or maybe the network card. So it kind of power supply is going to lead you astray a little bit.
Gotcha.
See here. I've addressed the alarms, the supervisors' trouble when they come in. You're going to get the cues on the bottom to acknowledge them, to silence them, and to reset the panel. You can certainly disarm. Points. You can certainly disarm your audibles, etc., from this panel here. Alright, menu. Function keys where I have the disarm points available. And then what do you want to do? I want to disarm my AVs. It goes red, and I execute it. I want to disarm my air handler shutdowns. Execute. I want to disable my elevator recalls. Execute. Cancel to come out of the screen. Alert menu is where my main menu, everything normally happens. So I'll have to come back out to alert. See all the troubles came in. I'll acknowledge my troubles. And you know where we're at. I scroll up and down to see how many I have.
Now these hook to the elevators for them to shut off in case of a fire.
That will bypass, explain your question a little more.
You know, some buildings, when there's a fire alarm, some the elevators automatically shut off.
Right.
Is this system doing that?
Yes, you have shunt trips if there are, if the heat detectors are active in the pits, in the top of shafts, or your elevator machine rooms, the shunt detector will kill power to the elevators.
Okay.
So they're done wherever they're at.
All right.
Unless they're bypassed, one.
Right.
Two, I would have to get with your elevator company to see, do they have an automatic floor reset? Are you gonna be stuck between floors?
Right.
Or are
they
gonna drop you down to a floor and kill power?
Right.
I don't know the answer on this particular controller here.
Yeah, that's what I need to find out.
Yeah, because it's not a high rise.
Right.
So a high rise, yeah, would be.
Drop you down to.
Drop you down to, yeah.
But your cues are gonna come up. Audio visuals are bypassed. Gives you one trouble for the entire scenario. So you're not printing out, you have the capability of a printer here, but no printer installed. So you're not printing out 158 troubles for speaker circuits disarmed. You get one trouble come in, go back up. for, well, this PMI-2 person-machine interface, that's your motherboard, okay? Main system controller, signal circuits are disarmed. That's something you just automatically link in a kit when you bypass your AVs. All right. RHU shutdowns. I don't have one trouble for telling you the air handlers are shut down. You're going to get all the different troubles associated with those air handlers, as well as elevators, alternate, primary, fire hats, shunt trips. All right, but the one trouble you get for AVs, so you don't have, I want to say about 50 AV circuits here. You don't want to get all the messages for that. All right, if I want to put the system back in, I go back up to my menu, I go back up to my function keys, and I re-enable. Execute, enable, execute, enable, execute. Partial system disabled light went away. Go back to alert, and we're back to our original four troubles because it's self-restored. If you need to disarm a point, let me look up here and see if I can see the address of one of these points are. All right, let's see, 12-025 is a smoke detector up top. I'll go menu, and I'll go to maintenance. And you see the fire alarm node pops up, the main panel. Okay. Let's see, I need to get more information because I need to go all the way down to loop 12. So give me more information. All these DACnet cards are your voice modules throughout. Scroll down. DLC card, lower level east loop 12. I know that smoke detector is 12-025. All right, so now I'm at the loop card. I go more information again, and it goes to all the different addresses that are on that loop card. More information, more information, more information. I want to just go to type 025.
Nice. Pretty neat. No, that's
boom. All right. So, for the, like I said, we had an address 209 right here on the power supply. I don't want to scroll down 209.
Right.
Go to 209. All right. So now I'm at smoke lower level zone 1 standby power room. All right. I'll go to control. The password in your log is going to be 5 ones. 11111. Usually takes a fingertip, because when they calibrate this thing, it's however accurate that my finger was. I try to be really good, but as a rule, I put them on the top right corner. You'll see it pop up 11111. 5 of them. Done. And I want to disarm the point. It tells me I'm looking at HFP at address. Mm-hmm. 25. Disarm. Execute. Disarm device. Address 25. Yep.
That's what I'm doing.
Go. Get a partial disable light. Cancel out. Cancel out. Cancel out. Go back to my alert screen. Acknowledge my trouble. That's really helpful if you know somebody's working on smokes in that area. If you need to bypass the addresses for maybe the jockey pump or the fire pump.
Sir, how can we manage those?
We have
the dishwasher,
right? I think it'd be some.
Okay, but not industrial type.
No.
Okay.
That's good.
Those things set off points all the time.
I still have AVs bypassed. That'll clear up in a minute when we go back to it. Your smoke detectors. For this fire alarm system, it's a smoke detector and it's a heat detector. It has a possible relay base for the output. Basically, it's three inputs: smoke, heat, what they call a neural. N-E-U-R-A-L. It doesn't just sniff for smoke and then go into alarm. It's programmed to say this is a utility room or this is an electrical room. This is an office space. This is a parking garage. This is an elevator pit. It's a duct detector. It knows that depending on what it's programmed for, different environment is going to cause different things. I'm going to have fumes in the parking garage. All right, so it decreases the amount of sensitivity to fumes. All right, it plays, I want to say, 20 different possible algorithms, use a big word. It just puts them all together, and depending on what that device is programmed for, that's the level that sets its sensitivity. So if I bypass the device, it's going to bypass the smoke, it's going to bypass the heat, it's going to bypass the neural input, and it's going to bypass any relay output that may or may not have been assigned to it. So there's four troubles right off the bat. Plus that main system is 5, plus the 4 root pinger. I want to go back to my menu, go back to maintenance. You'll see the device has got a dot right there beside it, telling me this guy is disarmed already. I'll go back to my control, rearm it, execute, partial disable light goes away, cancel, and alert to the main menu.
So you didn't have to put in 25, you'd already pick it up.
I scrolled down to 25, and I told it to disarm. In the same way, any point in the fire alarm system here, and like I said, you all have the points list. Imagine we put it right here in a document as well. You can pick out the points that you want to disarm and walk through the procedure. In that document, I'll also have the operator's notebook, operator's guide. It will walk you through how to step-by-step go to each device, how to do bypasses, the functions, etc. I'll have that in the 3-ring binder here.
So you're providing that?
I'll provide that.
Yeah.
I'll bring back out here when I bring out the power supplies and clear these guys out. So self-restoring.
Right. No, just before we walk away, I have a question about the attributes.
Okay.
You call them algorithms. So the attributes are part of the software that's already been programmed. It has nothing to do necessarily with the outputs from the individual devices. So in other words, when we identify this one, it's in a storage room that could be dusty.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been so the program will detune the signal coming from this so that it will minimize nuisance trips by dust and that sort of thing. But that's happening in there, not in the device.
That's correct.
So if someone swaps out that device,
tonight,
right?
Program an address 25, all you have to do is address 25, slap it in, fire alarm system takes over.
Okay, so it knows that 25 has where it is and the attributes that it's going to collect the data.
Yes.
Accordingly.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's all
right,
controlling
all right.
The program.
All right, thanks.
Program
so
knows,
educated.
The program knows
wondering.
That
yeah,
it's
I'm
an HFP 11 smoke detector. You have, I want to say, on the lower, let's see, we have HFP 11s. On the lower level, on the first floor, all the way up to the top, you have a different type of smoke detector, FDOT or FDT or, FDOTs, FDOTs is what we refer to them as. So you can't use an HFP to snap in.
Okay.
Physically, they look different.
Yeah.
The FDOTs or FDOTs don't have that extension honeycomb coming off the bottom of the smoke detector there. So that'll be an easily indication. If you were to swap the two, if I were to bring an F dot and put it up there, I would get an incorrect device ID trouble.
Hmm.
It says address 25 is supposed to be an HFP and something else is there instead. All right, so
nice.
You can have the right address.
Wrong device.
Wrong device, it'll tell you.
Beautiful.
Let's see, right address. Some troubles you'll get. Input source malfunction. If I look at the blinking TRIs, or HTRIs in this case, those are conventional monitoring points. They take a dry contact and give it an address. So I'm monitoring the point for transfer switch here. Transfer switch goes in trouble, it closes the contact, device sees that closure and says, transfer switch in trouble. It monitors a relay going across the normally open contact in your transfer switch. If your transfer, if the relay starts getting loose, maybe you have a 14 gauge wire and a super thin resistor, all right, you know they don't match up very well, you'll start getting an input source malfunction. You're probably gonna get in and out because it's not making good contact. That's just telling you that whatever it's monitoring, whether it be the resistor or the device itself, but usually it's the resistor, it can't see the resistor, right? MXL would give you a device response too low. XLS gives you input source malfunction. You get device requires servicing. Don't have that many duct detectors, maybe 3 to 6 duct detectors per floor. Sounds about right. If they start getting too dirty, and I don't think that the environment here is gonna create that problem, but you'll get a device requires servicing. Same kind of thing. You can pull them off. You can just take a small jeweler's tip screwdriver, pry the faceplate off, just pops off on either side. Spray can of air, clean it all out, snap it back on again, throw it in. The panel does not require anything else saying the device was cleaned. It'll just pick it up and go from there. Input source malfunction, device requires servicing, device not responding. Okay. You'll also notice if you get a device not responding, you're not going to be blinking green, period. You're not going to be blinking at all. Should. If you get a device not responding, you may also get a incorrect device ID. Typically, you're going to get one and the same. If you reset the panel and it still doesn't see it, then you're just going to get the device not responding. So it just starts losing communication. So it doesn't respond anymore. Two separate troubles are gonna mean the same thing. All right, so that's types of devices out in the field that you may have trouble with. You have pull stations, you have heats, not many. You have smokes, you have a few ducts, you have relays for shutdowns, you have tampers and flows in the stairwells. They are all labeled in the program for specific area that they're servicing. And that's pretty much all your field devices. I think the only heats I've seen are the pits. And then the TRIs that monitor the closed points. Pardon?
Heats in the garage.
You have heats in the garage and the elevator lobbies. I know they just recently came out and made some more changes to the parking garage. So what they have added in, I'm not 100% sure yet.
How many attempts on the dial is it set for?
I'm thinking it's set for 5.
That's the highest?
I think it'll go to 10. It may be set for 10, but I'm trying to remember what I did 3 months ago.
Can I don't remember. It to 10?
I can definitely set it for the highest level, yeah.
Steve?
Yes?
In regards to the garage, you just mentioned it, so there's dry systems out there. Are the pumps, the pony pumps out there, and you know, the pressure regulation, is that monitored by this console?
Yes. All the fire alarm points in the garage are monitored by this panel.
Okay.
They have recently made changes to the garage as far as the dry system. Recently, meaning I think last week. And I'm not familiar with what changes they made. So if the dry system is installed and up and running, then it's being monitored now.
Thank you.
But yes, everything is being monitored through here. What's some other questions while I try to figure out what's next? Other things you experience when you get called out in the middle of the night. You know, we can acknowledge, we can silence. If the alarms are going off, we can acknowledge.
Power supplies. I mean, power failures. If they got power failure in the area, then the power comes back up.
Right.
Just as one self-restore on that, or do we have to come out to reset that?
It's a good question. The question was, is the AC brownout self-restoring? I don't know that answer. We're going to find that out. put a power down each panel, and you should all know that as well. In this panel, I've got one power supply controller. In some of the panels, depending on how much amplification, how many ZAC amplifier cards they needed, they have two. You have a PSC, which is a controller, that's the brain, and you have a PSX beside it, which is basically extra power. Both of them are going to have the pigtail coming from the transfer board to the power supply itself. So if I want to kill my AC, if I want to take a panel down out in the field, turn off my DC power, and disconnect my AC. So I'm in power fail right now. My backup batteries are covering me. My PSC is blinking power. That tells me I've lost main AC. The question was, do they self-restore? And right now I've got one trouble for main AC fail. I'm gonna acknowledge it. I still got a power flashing light there telling me I've lost main AC power. Has not cleared back up yet. Boy, that was a stupid thing to do. Only because I'm on video doing training right now. Now it has cleared back up. We're back down to the four trolls. Okay. It did self-restore.
Yeah, the question is, would it self-restore without you acknowledging or doing anything?
Yeah, that's what
I have not experienced.
So
nobody's, that
part. You know what I mean? Nobody's here.
Right.
They lose power for 15 minutes.
Right.
Okay. Is that going to restore, or if every time they lose power for 15 minutes, is someone going to have to run out here in the middle of the night
and reset the panel?
And reset the panel.
That's what I'm
doing. Okay.
Yeah. Well, without even touching the thing, will it?
Right. Let me kill the main power again, so we're back to battery. Simulate the trouble.
MCV. About maybe a door.
Watch and see and wait. Because I've never been called back out in the middle of the night because of that. So no. I don't have that quick answer for you. But we'll see.
They wouldn't be able to do that.
So, would we see this problem when we do a generator transfer? Because momentarily, if the AC is not backed up by a UPS, you will have this condition.
Right.
Yes, and I think we had this problem already when we were doing a transfer. There's your self-restore.
There you okay, go. All right. So it's moot point.
Yep. Excellent.
Back down to four trolls.
You get
good and lucky when you're four.
You got lucky, Steve.
Your generator is working for you.
My name is Aaron Mulligan. Aaron Mulligan is the Chesapeake Area Tech Support Specialist. He's always on call 24/7 for us techs if there's something we run into. So he's our first point. He always answers the phone. For some reason, he'll still answer the phone at 1 o'clock in the morning. Next point is for me to call New Jersey in the afternoons, and they'll ask me how come I didn't call Aaron, because he already knows the answer. Mm. But you've got techs that have all the techs that we have in Vendors School for XLS, we're factory trained. I think 90% of the folks out of our office are NICET certified. So we have that to back us up. We have an area tech support specialist. If we can't find the answer, and I've been with Siemens for 9 years, and I still call them at least once or twice a week. So, and then we have New Jersey that's always on the phone, and they have an after-hours beeper. Beeper's probably the wrong word. But Aaron,
pager.
Pager, yeah. Aaron can get hold of them with a special passcode after hours if we were to get to that level. So we'll definitely have your answers for you as we go along.
Okay.
Some more questions.
Do you have the capability to start the fire pump or generator from here?
I don't have fire pump start. I monitor that the fire pump is ready, running, and right behind you is an enunciator. Give me a second here. Mm-hmm. We made
like
some changes.
So
right, we made some changes to the enunciator. So the specifics of it, this is pretty much what you see upstairs. I do have a key switch for system reset. You don't have to come down to the fire panel here. You can do the system reset upstairs in the lobby. You have to turn the key, you have to hold that key until you see everything cycle off and reset. All right, it is a momentary, it's gonna come back to the same position, but you gotta hold it until you see the recycle. And when the fire inspectors did their test last month, every single device they reset with the key down there. So it definitely works well.
So with this key switch here, you can start the fire pump?
Yeah, that's what I'm wondering.
Yeah, right.
If you can start it there, where it says auto and on, if you can turn it and...
Well, these lights on the right are obviously just telling you the fire department is running. Generator's running. It's on auto if there's a fault. I don't want to give you the say yes.
Gotcha.
You turn the key on.
I'm just wondering, is there any buttons also on the main panel there? You know what I mean? Like you could come up to it. Say like you're doing a...
Just curious what's up here. Stairs. These are all the voice speakers.
That's the voice and speaker. Okay, gotcha. Okay.
Which is, I'm glad you bring that up because that walks me to the next.
Yeah, because I was wondering about the paging system and stuff. Yeah.
All right, you have the messages are common Fairfax County message. Emergency has been reported in the building. Please exit by the nearest elevators. Stairs, do not use elevators. All right. I have the microphone here. I can do a select E. I can push the top right left button here for all evac, and the building's in a dump.
Is that also going to, when you do that, is that also going to dial out?
It is not going to dial out.
Okay.
Having said that, the guy that wrote the program could easily have put it in there to dial out. But an all evac basically is get out of the building.
And you say the building will dump?
Yes.
Yeah, because my question on that too is, let's say, you know, if they have to run fire drills.
Right.
You know what I mean? They may have to run a fire drill every 6 months.
You got to do one five for the whole year.
Okay, so then they're going to have to come down. And what's the simple procedure for these guys to come down, page everybody, say that we are, you know, or they may even do the fire drill without paging. You know what I mean? And then come down and say, I'm doing a fire drill. I don't want the fire department to come, you know, call it out, obviously, but to make sure that.
If they're going to do a drill, they're going to notify the fire department to show up or not show up. All right. They're probably not going to tell the occupants of the building that they're doing a drill.
Right.
But if I were, I select all call. I'm flashing green, nothing here. Okay, we're flashing green over here. Once I key the mic, you're going to hear 900 hertz tone here play for about 3 seconds. When it stops, then the mic can make an announcement.
Now, so the automatic system that announces now won't come on just like it's a fire drill? I mean, like it's a fire alarm?
It's just like a PA system now.
Right now, I'm using the all call as a PA system throughout every fire alarm speaker in the building.
Okay.
May I have your attention, please? We are conducting a brief test of the fire alarm system. Please disregard all fire alarm indications. I repeat, we are conducting a brief test of the fire alarm system. Please disregard all fire alarm indications.
You really need to do that?
No, they're building operations. I don't do it, but if I can notify us.
So that came through live with no delay at all.
We'll have somebody else who'll be doing it.
Yeah. Right. Oh, okay. I pointed to this ready-to-page light right here on the corner.
Yeah, gotcha.
Once I key the mic, once it's ready for me to speak, that light will come on, and then I can talk.
Okay.
All right. Also, some systems, depending on the microphone itself, if that light is on, the mic is hot.
Yeah.
All right, some of our MXLs, I have not seen it with an XLS yet, but I don't want to either. So just be cautious. If that ready to page light is active, anything you say can and will be held against you.
Yeah. Did you see that?
I would love to say I've never been in that environment.
Right.
Now, I saw you do it with the microphone. Now, what if you just wanted to run a fire drill? What would you push? But you said that a dump, the building though, right?
I got a diesel.
Well, that's what you want.
That means get everybody out.
Get everybody out, so you'd want to need.
Normally, you would just pull a device.
Yeah. So that'll automatically come on with the automatic voice command and all that, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. That's what I want to see.
Yeah. There you go.
Three times, right?
May I have your attention, please?
Okay. I think it was two.
May I have your attention, please? There has been a fire emergency reported in the building.
But I would have to call it out first so the fire department won't come, and then we'll push that.
Right. Well, let's answer that question for this particular building.
Right.
Mike, is the building still called out?
Yes, every day they call it out.
Okay. Okay.
So I'll reconnect my dialer. It's going to dial out for troubles. Okay. That's an active indicator right now. Underneath the power button, if you're unfamiliar with this model dialer, is a tiny little white button, very small. Okay? That's my silence button. All it does is stop the beeping here in my ear. That's all it does. You're still calling out. If I put a monitor to the port here, it would still show that I'm dialing out for a system trouble right now. If it goes active again, then I would have a new signal coming back through it again. So that's telling me right now, by doing a drill here, I'm not dialing back out.
May I have your attention, please? There has been a fire emergency reported in the building. Please evacuate.
So I've heard this part. He'll be trying to coordinate with his people.
If I just want to do a select page, I can do a all evac, which dumps the building. I can do an all call, which calls everybody in the building, all floors, all speakers. I can do a select evac to say, let's just talk to the lower level. Select evac. I'm dumping the lower level only.
May I have your attention, please? There has been a fire emergency reported in the building. Please evacuate.
All right, and then the select page is what I was trying to allude to. And do a select page to talk to lower level only.
Test, test. This completes our test of the fire alarm system. I repeat, this completes our test of the fire alarm system. Thank you.
Can you hold it again and say, now get back to work?
Yeah.
Right, Mike?
Too late. They're all out of the building. Government building, I'll be back tomorrow morning. Yeah, that works. All right, so all evac, select evac, all call, select call. For the selects, you choose which floor, which area you want to receive the message. All right, they consist of stairwells, lower level, first floor, all the way up to the fourth floor rooftop. Dialer's back reconnected. I think now we can walk over maybe to a comm closet. Yep. Mike, do we have access?
I can go.
Is that pager only down here? I mean, the paging system, it's only...
In this room.
In this room. Okay.
We do not have a remote pager.
We have an active shooter. I'm going to have to make it to this room.
You have to make it to this room, right.
But they also going to have the degress system. With the security guards and all that, yeah.
Gotcha. That's what I was thinking, if you could go.
Yeah, and what we did also is, and I got to give it James Cameron, we set it up to, if one of those systems go off, the camera goes into that area.
Gotcha.
So we can know exactly what's going on right then.
This is the FDOT, FDOT, FDO 421 in this particular case. The T would tell me it has a thermal element that's being used in this building. You'll see the top surface is nice and smooth. Compared to the HFPs, which are down here on the lower level, they have that little extension honeycomb to it. So if you are replacing a device or removing one, maybe it's false alarming or it's just stuck in alarm, and you pull it out and get everything calm, I can pull out, let's say this device is active. I can remove it from the ceiling and come back over here. I can reset the fire panel. It's no longer in alarm. I know the device is no longer responding, so I'm going to go more information. I can get an address for it. I can disarm that point, and then I can snap it back up there in there all day long. Fire panel won't care anything about what it does. So I can get an address. Just make sure you're putting the right devices back in. Okay. If I replace it.
Did he show you how to disarm or disable a individual point?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll scroll down to address 25.
Yeah, gotcha. But with the good thing about it, it has a keypad. All you got to do is punch it in, and it'll pop it right up.
Gotcha.
Right.
You're not scrolling through 200 something ones.
And while we're down here too, the other request that I could see these guys getting is having a contractor here and asking them to disable the system. You know, we need to call it out and, you know, right. Say, hey, I'm calling out just in case something goes off, right. So disabled. Is there just like an all disabled, or was it like you did before? You're gonna have to go through individual.
If you come back up to menu.
Okay.
Function keys. And then I'll disarm my alarms.
So you have to go through each, it's not like an all, it's each correct. Individual.
Correct.
Okay.
You can disarm the loops. Come back out. I went to maintenance. In this case, I am currently all the way down at the device level. I'm going to walk back out the tree. That's the loop card. And then there's the node, the next level, right?
Gotcha.
So if I go to the node, and I want to scroll down to DLC loop 12. And then let's go to control. Again, the password is 5 1s. 1 1 1 1 1. Done. Disarm. DLC loop card 12, all devices. Unable to process. Cancel, cancel, cancel. Alert tells me that I've got 176 troubles right now. Every device is 4 inputs, it's 1 output, or 3 inputs and 1 output. So that's 4 points per device is being disarmed. Times however many devices are on that loop. And I got 176 troubles. Go back to more maintenance. I'm already at the last level I left. I'll go to control. I'll tell it to rearm. Execute. It tells me arm devices, DLC at address 12. That's the whole card. I'm not sure what just pops up with the unable to process, but go back to alert. It clearly has because I'm back down to 4 troubles.
Gotcha.
Let's see, there was a point in that process. Bear with me for a second here. Maintenance. Let's go right here to walk test. Anybody familiar with what walk test is for MXL? What does it mean for you?
And if we're testing, I can pull a device and put it in walk test. I won't have to have anyone here at the panel. Silence once I reset it from the device. It's
okay.
Clear. I mean,
if somebody, right? If I want to put the building in walk test or loop, in this case, this will do one loop at a time, not the whole building. So I go to DLC card 12 and I put loop 12 in bypass. Then I can smoke it. I can do anything I want to. I can activate pulsations. I will get a 3-second indication up here on the fire panel. Alarm in, walk test, pulsation 12, and then it goes away. So if you're not watching the panel when you put it in walk test, you don't know that it happened. So if I'm putting loop 12 in bypass, and I'm working down at the end of the corridor on the tampers and flows, somebody has a heart attack in the stairwell, hits a pulsation to save their life, and nobody knows it.
Mm-hmm. Didn't happen.
Yeah. Be cautious about walk tests. Because it pops in and goes away, and then nobody knows anything after that.
Right. I guess I was speaking from an inspector's standpoint.
Right, and that's, as an inspector,
right.
I want it because I don't want to dump everything in the building. I don't want to trip all the doors. I don't want to activate all the different peripherals. A walk test will not cause any peripheral device. Won't activate the enunciator. Won't trip relays. Won't shut down air handlers. Won't close doors. Won't trip elevators. It's a nice thing to do if I'm doing a test. But if I don't have somebody looking at it when it's happening, I have no record. And if something bad happened elsewhere, something bad happened.
So no record means that it doesn't store the walk test results?
It will store everything in memory,
okay.
But it won't keep it up on the display.
Right.
It will print it out if we had a printer installed.
There you go.
It'll say alarm and walk test on the device.
Do it monitors the data?
Dialer does not monitor it. That's a good question because I've always got everything called out. I don't know that answer for you. If I'm, I don't think it does, but knock on wood, I don't put myself in that position intentionally.
So we wouldn't know if the dialer's in trouble?
Yeah, the dialer would.
Your dialer's going to be.
But yeah, I guess it's going to call and tell you, right, you're going to get the.
Yeah, as soon as you put it in walk test, you get a cue that says your devices are in walk test, and it's going to put a trouble out. ASD is what, basically for sensitivity for a generic term, but is what tells this smoke detector it's in a mechanical room versus an elevator pit versus a lobby or an office space. When I smoke a device, the algorithm goes through all the different what-ifs and says, okay, I've got enough smoke now, let's trip it. If I go in there and I turn ASD settings off, it says smoke, boom. Goes that quick. So you'll have that.
Are these multifunction heads too, or are you just smoke, or are they smoke, heat?
Yeah.
So they're
smoke, these types, that honeycomb bottom has got a little thermal tip on it.
Right.
So that'll work on rate of rise. And then the neural, like I said, was the third point.
Gotcha.
They all have a relay option, whether it's turned on or not. So that's why when I disarmed that point, I got four troubles.
Gotcha.
Smoke, thermal, neural, outputs.
Gotcha. So you're getting four troubles per device.
Yes, gotcha. You disarm it. Yes.
So you'll get that relay device even though it's not being used?
Correct. Okay. It'll tell you the output is disarmed.
Got it. Okay.
Whether or not output is being used for it.
Okay.
And is all the data loops, they all, I guess it's a Class A loop?
This building is definitely Class A, yes.
No TTAP.
No TTAP. Let me see where I'm at in this process. Alert goes back to the main menu you want to see. Standard four troubles that are there right now. We can pause and go take a look at one of the cabinets that is consistent with the rest of the cabinets.
Okay. Can I have to have backlights for the panels?
Uh-huh.
You said
it. Now the LED backlight tends to go away, die out. Right now these are, will stay just like that. Okay. All right.
Everybody called me to yesterday.
How are you? I was about to say the thing, but I said I had to go do it.
Yeah. You have to play a little bit.
So you say. Alright, this panel is consistent with the rest of the panels on the floor. Here on the east side of the building, it is in the same room on every floor. Riser is just going straight up. Over on the west side, it's in the opposite corridor, so it's adjacent to us. All right, and coming all the way down. DACnet, again, this is your voice. Very critical. If the main DACnet in the fire panel were to go bad, and that's what holds all your messages. Each of these DACnets in the field have a backup message in them. So they would take over and play. Network card is what communicates up and down. A digital loop card, device loop card, your smokes, your pulls, your heats, your relays, etc. Addressable devices. The ZIC-4A are your Class A strobe circuits. Your ZACs down on the bottom are zone audio cards, amplifiers, both. So it has the amplifiers in it to bump the voice out, relays to turn them all on. That's your speakers. Extender for the power supply, PSX, and the power supply controller itself. If I wanted to do any work in here, I would turn off the batteries, disconnect the batteries. The best way to do it is just simply turning them off on the toggle switches. Click, click, and then take your main AC jumpers and disconnect them from the backboard. The unit will be dead. I can do anything I want to. If I needed to do any kind of a reset on the DACnet, on the voice system, maybe third floor is just going off. Lost communication, so it's going to take over itself and it's stuck.
in the DAC net, the voice card is a hot swappable module. The only hot swappable module. Otherwise, bad things happen. And as I said before, everything is disconnectable. Phoenix connectors, just pop them right off, right back on. I obviously picked one that didn't have any loops on it. But if I wanted to do that with a DLC card, it would not be a problem.
You said the controls are Class A. How about the speakers? Are they Class A? Everything's Class A here.
Yes.
Nice.
Including the network.
You don't have to put your line resistors anyplace. It's
Back in the panel here.
Back in the panel.
My voice system, my end of lines are right here. 68K ohms. My strobe circuits, the end of lines are right here. 24K ohms. So no resistors out in the field. Don't want to see resistors out in the field. If you do, it's a bad thing.
That net DLC speakers and strobes.
This box is just carbon copy all the other floors, depending on whether or not they have a second amplifier, in this case third. You have a backup amplifier, the one all the way on the extreme right, exact 30s. You have your primary amplifier. In this case, you have a second amplifier because you have that many speakers on the floor. If either of the primary amps go bad, the backup automatically switches over and takes up care. You get a message on the fire panel saying your amplifier number one is in trouble, signal loss, or backed up. Usually it's going to say signal loss and backed up.
What size batteries do you use?
All of them use 100 amp hour backups. All the panels here.
It's 2.4.
100 amps here, in each panel is 2 12-volt 100 amp hour batteries.
And this is on both sides, and each one serves this side, that one serves that side, and
yes.
This floor only.
Correct. When you get to the fourth floor, I want to say the west, they did a change. So the fourth floor west panel is what's taking care of the penthouse, and I wanted to say stairwells, but I'm going to be wrong with that issue.
Excuse me.
You'll know because one of them's going to have the PSX extra power supply, one of them's not. You'll know which one's covering the main grunt upstairs. The garage is included in here. This guy's taking care of the garage. And I don't recall if these speakers or if the ones in the fire panel are taking care of the garage. If you were to open up the circuit, it would go into trouble for whichever speaker circuit it is. You got the different switches down below. I can't see right now. 1, 2, and 3. DLC circuits are on the thumb switches. So I'll know I got a 0, 1, 2 here telling me it's circuit 12. Network card is probably gonna be number 11. That probably says 10. I don't have my glasses on. Too old. All right. I think we did 10, 11, 12, 13, and 14. Then we go up one floor. It's going to be 20, 21,
22, 23, 24. 18, 17.
Yeah. That's the arrow. So as you go up each floor, like I said, it's going to go 12,
yeah, back
21, or DAC net card tells you everything. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. So you'll know where everything is. And it'll clearly say it on the printout on the control PMI. What other questions do you experience out there that maybe I'll help you out with?
XLS,
all right. It'll tell you, the fire panel will say XLS V or R V dash whichever panel. So in this case, it's gonna say XLS, R for remote, V for voice, dash one. One above us is gonna be dash two, dash three, dash four, dash five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10.
Are they labeled?
No. They're not. Well, no, they're not. Good question. Good answer. You definitely put a label on it.
How about we need to change the batteries on this panel? Don't we just like go through in
right.
2 years and change all the batteries?
Okay.
What's the proper procedure?
Procedure, same key, Siemens key, T45. Big monsters. Disconnect your toggle switches. It tells you batteries are disconnected. Okay. Also, cable going down to it. These two batteries are being shared by the two amplifiers. All right. So, if I only had a power supply, if I didn't have the extender, I would still have two batteries. I got both power supply and the extender. I still don't have two batteries. They're tapped down here off the device itself. Turn them off. Disconnect plug down below here. They'll just pull right out. There we go. And you're disconnected.
And the other one also, I guess.
Yes.
And when they send a lot of straight back to the other panel, to the main panel?
A trouble right now,
yeah.
Saying yeah.
Okay.
Definitely have a trouble right now at the panel. And it'll restore by the time we get back.
Alright.
That's my story, I'm sticking to it.
Alright.
Not too many times I do training lectures where I'm creating so many troubles.
Now, Eric, why did you have to cut that power off first?
To this.
Correct him?
Huh? It's not the
morning. Oh, okay.
That's air conditioner on.
Gotcha.
Alright. Other questions? All right, we'll go back to the main panel. That clears it all up, unless you got some more.
What am I going?